This is purely a journalistic point of view. Nothing more has been said in this video other than that of which has been reported by various media sources and backed up with sources seen at the end of this video.
Extreme Championship Wrestling revolutionized wrestling in the 1990s, with some believing it saved professional wrestling in the United States by bringing it back to its roots as a violent form of entertainment. Certainly, the WWF emulated some of ECW's features, such as hardcore wrestling and angles heavy on sexual innuendo, helping it overcome WCW. Even WCW adopted some of ECW's practices, particularly the use of hardcore matches. Both the WWF and WCW brought in ECW stars, usually failing to recapture the magic that made them so great in ECW. Unfortunately, ECW's core audience just wasn't enough to sustain the company, and in 2001, ECW went bankrupt, bought out by the WWF the same year the WWF purchased arch-rival WCW. Fans thought they'd seen the last of ECW, but in 2006, the WWE launched ECW as a one-hour show on the cable channel Sci-Fi. Fans wondered if WWE could bring ECW back to life, but their hopes were quickly dashed. Although the program lasted until 2010, it was ultimately seen as a failure, failing to live up to the standards of the original ECW. Join us now as Behind the Titantron looks at WWE's ECW, a botched reboot. Paul Heyman joined the WWF following ECW's collapse, working as a color commentator and eventual ECW figurehead during the invasion angle in 2001. Behind the scenes, Heyman reportedly lobbied hard for Vince McMahon to resurrect ECW. According to WWF creative team member Bruce Prichard, Heyman wanted Vince to bring Extreme Championship Wrestling back as a third brand, but Vinnie Mac and most of his advisors leaned toward WCW. Reportedly, Shane McMahon was the only player who supported ECW. The WWF chose WCW, beginning its invasion angle. By the end of 2001, both ECW and WCW were gone, the invasion storyline having fizzled out despite a strong start and fan support. It seemed as if both companies were destined for the history books, but in 2004, a surprise hit video changed Vince McMahon's mind, paving the way for the return of Extreme Championship Wrestling. In 2004, the WWE home video production The Rise and Fall of ECW became the second best-selling DVD in WWE history. The documentary was well-received by fans and sold an extraordinary number of copies, leading to Vince McMahon deciding to bring ECW back for a special reunion show. This show would become known as ECW One Night Stand. In 2005, the WWE held its pay-per-view ECW One Night Stand. The show proved successful and led to talk of resurrecting ECW. Eventually, the WWE decided to bring ECW back, reportedly reaching out to a number of ECW originals, even wrestlers who had left the WWE on bad terms. Fans wondered who would show up in ECW and how much it would compare to the original ECW. To hype the premiere, WWE aired a second One Night Stand pay-per-view, setting the stage for the promotion's relaunch. Vince McMahon brought Paul Heyman in to manage ECW, but there was no doubt who had the final word. Vince McMahon recognized Heyman's abilities to an extent, but Heyman reportedly was not looked upon favorably by Vince, Stephanie McMahon, or Triple H. According to an interview with former WWE writer Andrew Goldstein, "The three of them cannot stand Paul Heyman. They sit around and joke about Paul Heyman, about him sweating and his suits are cheap and he showed up in a rented, broken-down limo the first day he signed a contract to make himself look like a big deal, and they make fun of his ideas as they do imitations of him. But I think all three of them are extremely jealous of his brain." Heyman would guide ECW, but only as far as the WWE allowed him to. With the McMahons utilizing a heavy rein, how far could Heyman go in recreating the ECW magic that entertained its loyal fanbase? The WWE's 2006 One Night Stand offered ECW fans hope when Rob Van Dam won the WWE Championship from John Cena. With Paul Heyman crowning RVD as the ECW champion as well, ECW seemed like it was off to a good start, with the whole effing show carrying the ECW banner. However, RVD's propensity to light up shortened his title run. In July of 2006, he and Sabu were traveling through a well-known speed trap in West Virginia when their car was pulled over. RVD was caught with 18 grams of marijuana and 5 Vicodin, while Sabu had drug paraphernalia and several tablets of testosterone. Both men were slapped with wellness policy violations, and RVD dropped the WWE Championship to Edge and the ECW Championship to The Big Show. ECW was off to a bad start. The WWE's version of ECW premiered on Sci-Fi on the 13th of June 2006, with one moment symbolizing the entire relaunch. Since the show aired on Sci-Fi, some believed the WWE decided to throw the network a bone by including a sci-fi-themed character. Thus, a zombie appeared, before getting beat down by ECW original The Sandman. Wrestling lore has it that the WWE originally wanted to have Sandman beat up a Martian character, but Sci-Fi vetoed the idea. In the end, the zombie served as a symbol of the new ECW, a mindless reanimation of a once energetic promotion. It's not difficult to explain what went wrong with the WWE's version of ECW, but for those who have forgotten how bad it was, here are some painful reminders. ECW delivered impressive ratings for Sci-Fi, earning a 2.79, earning the top spot on cable that night. The summer series quickly became a permanent one, with Sci-Fi renewing the program's contract. However, fans of the original ECW saw little to remind them of the show they once loved. It's difficult to imagine anyone expecting the PG-rated WWE producing the R-rated product ECW became known for in its early days. To be fair, even ECW toned down its sex and violence when the show aired on TNN, an example of how mainstream publicity often dilutes an innovative product. The new ECW did have blood and weapons, but it was nothing like the glory days of the original, and the publicly traded WWE was not going to air a product that went against its corporate image. ECW became ECW Lite, an oxymoron that quickly became a joke. The WWE found itself in an odd position with ECW. The company seemed to want to appeal to ECW's fanbase, but they also seemed concerned that the show would flop without the presence of WWE superstars. The result was the WWE included a number of WWE superstars on the ECW roster, and, as was the case with the WWE Invasion, the stars of another company took the back seat, putting over WWE. To be fair, WWE's approach wasn't a complete failure. ECW did serve as a platform to introduce and establish new stars. CM Punk, The Miz, and John Morrison either debuted on ECW or were relaunched there, striking gold. Where things went wrong was the proliferation of secondary stars such as Big Daddy V, Chavo Guerrero, and Hardcore Holly, who seemed to be there because they'd worn out their welcome on Raw and SmackDown. The problem was when guys like Chavo Guerrero won the ECW Championship, insinuating ECW was a third-class promotion where WWE castoffs prevailed over ECW's best. Vince McMahon's surprise win over Bobby Lashley for the ECW Championship turned off many fans. Even today, fans are divided on Vince McMahon's brief reign as WWF champion, with some believing it served an important storyline purpose, while others look at it as a lesson in vanity. However, Vince's reign as ECW champion was seen by all but a handful of apologists as a bad idea, alienating fans further, regardless of the storyline purpose. No discussion of ECW would be complete without mentioning Braden Walker, the artist formerly known as Chris Harris in TNA. Harris teamed with James Storm to form America's Most Wanted, one of wrestling's hottest tag teams in the 2000s. His signing to WWE was highly anticipated, but when Harris appeared on ECW, it was obvious he was going nowhere. Within weeks, he was gone from the WWE, with fans mocking his short run and Braden Walker Hall of Fame memes going viral. According to Bruce Pritchard, the Chris Harris that showed up for work wasn't the one they signed months earlier. Harris was out of shape and unmotivated, leading to his early departure. The WWE's December to Dismember pay-per-view highlighted everything wrong with the WWE version of ECW. The show aired exactly a week after Survivor Series and had two matches promoted. Some sources indicate only the main event was hyped. The show ran short, featured WWE superstars going over ECW stars, and led to Paul Heyman leaving ECW. The main event was an Elimination Chamber match for the ECW Championship, with Big Show defending the belt against Sabu, CM Punk, Bobby Lashley, Rob Van Dam, and Test. Fans were outraged when Sabu was involved in an injury angle and replaced with Hardcore Holly. According to Bruce Pritchard, Paul Heyman wanted CM Punk to dominate the match, eliminating opponent after opponent with the Anaconda Vice until he emerged ECW champion. Vince McMahon wasn't going along with it and penciled Lashley in as his new champion. The pay-per-view ran a reported 2 hours and 17 minutes, much shorter than the average pay-per-view, which often stretched over 2.5 hours. Given the cost, $40, and the quality of the card, there was no doubt why viewers demanded a refund. It was clear the timing had been mismanaged, infuriating Vince McMahon further. McMahon wasn't the only one, as Heyman clashed with McMahon over the show, ending in Heyman's dismissal from the company. Years later, Heyman would tell Steve Austin on the Stone Cold podcast, "I didn't like the way it was going. It was a very personal fight between me and Vince. I was burned out, I was tired, I had lost my life for it, and I couldn't find my way anymore." Was Heyman fooling himself how far he could take ECW? Was the WWE fooling itself into thinking it could somehow improve ECW? The ECW pay-per-view became the lowest-ordered show in WWE history, drawing a reported 90,000 buys. To no one's surprise, there was no further talk of another ECW pay-per-view, and the show consistently ranks at the top when ranking the creme de la crap of wrestling pay-per-views. By 2009, ECW's ratings were frequently on the cusp of 1.0, proving the WWE version of ECW was a bad idea from the beginning. As the adage goes, just because you can do something doesn't mean you should do it. The WWE tried to put its spin on a revolutionary promotion, but without adding anything revolutionary to it. Simply put, the WWE was unwilling to recreate the ECW magic. Not everyone believes the WWE's ECW was destined to fail. In an interview with Ring Rust, Tommy Dreamer explained, "A lot of fans saw that with WWE's version of ECW. There was a lot of great stuff about it, but it was attributed to a lot of people. It was more like, hey, this is an ECW because you don't have Paul Heyman stirring the pot or Tommy Dreamer helping. And it became another WWE product. For me, if they said, here it is and you have 100% creative autonomy, then yes. How do I know that word? Because I wrote 2005 ECW One Night Stand and I had total creative autonomy. And that show was a huge financial success for them as well as a creative success. Ultimately, the WWE alienated ECW fans and turned off newer fans who were unfamiliar with the original ECW product. On the 2nd of February 2010, Vince McMahon announced ECW was ending and would be replaced by new wrestling programming. That show would be NXT and turned into one of the WWE's most innovative shows. A reminder, it's sometimes better to let the classics remain memories and look to new endeavors for success. Well guys, that was episode 28 of Behind the Titantron. Be sure to check out more episodes in the playlist shown. Subscribe if you haven't already. See you next time with more wrestling content.